Man, it's been a crazy year for Believers Church. I'm excited to be able to speak to you kind of the week before our actual start of the fall and our new fall series, which I'm kind of kicking off today, but Pastor Mark's really going to do it right next week. But if we've tried to do one thing this year, I was thinking about this and getting prepared. We've tried to cast vision this year. I mean, if you go all the way back to January, when Pastor Mark was officially installed as our lead pastor, we hit the ground running. And I don't know if you can tell, but we've done a lot in 1 year. We are so thrilled about what God has done and what God has graced us with. I mean, just the fact that this past week we were able to launch student B groups. That is a huge win in my heart. I'm going to tell you something. I have wanted to do that for years because my personal testimony involves the power of one-on-one discipleship. I have been much more impacted in my life through one-on-one discipleship than I have through the corporate gathering. I love the corporate gathering. I have experienced some powerful things in the presence of God with other believers, and I have had my life changed by powerful words that I've heard spoken by men and women of God. But the lifelong impact of one-on-one discipleship, that is my heart. That is the true core of my testimony. And even this week, in our first week in high school B groups, we had a student bring a friend who didn't know Christ, and she met Christ right at their B group this very first week. So yeah, absolutely amazing. We launched all kinds of new groups this week. We have groups for empty nesters, for people with children, without children. We have a meeting on just about every night of the week now. If you're not connected in a B group, I just want to give you a hard plug this morning, shameless plug. Go get signed up in the foyer. You are missing out. You need to get involved, and we have just about every option we can. A lot more options than we had in January, and that's the point I was making. We cast vision. We started telling you that we're leading people to encounter Jesus. We did the Big Ten this summer. We launched B groups twice in 1 year, and we just installed new elders last Sunday. It's been a cool year. It's been awesome for me because I told Pastor Mark the other day, if I'm sitting there on the phone talking with my friends, you know, that maybe I went to Bible college with or who are in ministry in other parts of the country, it feels so good for me to be able to say this has probably been the most biblical year I have ever lived as a minister. My church is actually doing the things the New Testament says we should do. We gather in homes. We gather corporately. We elect men as elders. We preach the word. We devote ourselves to the study of Scripture. And those things are so important to me. So I am thrilled that Pastor Mark let me kick off today. And as I was preparing, I noticed something. You know, you hear us say the same things over and over and over a lot because we believe in the power of repetition. We believe the way you cast vision is through repetition. When you read the New Testament, there are many different authors. Now, we're a church. We believe that the Scripture is 100% true. I want you to know that, all right? And we believe that it's powerful. And y'all hear me say this all the time. You got to get hungry for the Word. You've got to expect God to do something. I believe that. I believe the amount that you receive from God is always directly connected to the amount of faith that you have. I believe faith moves God's heart. It's impossible to please God without faith. You can't come to His grace without faith. You need faith to please God. And when it comes to His Word, I believe that you have to stir yourself up. Don't sit there like a spectator. You're not Simon Cowell, and I'm not a contestant. You're here to hear the Word of God. You're here to be moved and changed, and it's meant to be applied and put into action by faith in your life. So if you stir up your faith to say, man, God will speak to me today, He will speak to you today. There's a million things that I'm going to say that I didn't mean to say or some things I did mean to say, and if you will tune yourself in and have faith, God will speak to some area of your life. I believe that 100%. If He can use a donkey, He can use me. Amen, somebody. All right. So we are going to get into God's Word today. Stir up your faith. Stir up your faith that God will speak to you. Just don't sit back and be a spectator, and I promise I won't be so long. All right? Let's pray. Father God, we do love You, and thank You for Your Word. We ask that You open our minds to understand it. We know that by the power of Your Holy Spirit, we can know it and understand it and put it into action. Help us by the power of Your Holy Spirit to apply it to our life, to write it on the tablets of our hearts, and to represent it for all it is. God, we know it is all true, but we recognize it is difficult to understand. So help us today, and we praise You. In Jesus' name, amen. So in casting vision, you have to be repetitive. And in the early church, there was something I noticed this week as I was getting prepared. There was something that kept showing up. Now, sometimes I'll get up here and say something a certain way when it comes to our vision, and then Pastor Mark will get up here and he'll say it in his way because he's 25 years older than me and has his own style and things like that. But there are certain things in our vision that we very purposefully say exactly the same way. Why? Because we believe in building a culture. And we believe language is important to culture. So you'll maybe sometimes you'll think, man, they say that over and over and over and over. Well, the reason why is we want it to stick. We want it to get planted deep down in your heart. If last year I had asked you, what's the vision of Believers Church? You'd been like, that's him. There's your man. And if I asked you today, hopefully you would say, man, it's to lead people to encounter Jesus through love, power, and community. Because we say that all the time. We purposely say that all the time. And as I was getting prepared for Tested, our new series, I noticed that a lot of the apostles talked about being tested. And they said something exactly the same way. They said that you are being tested. When you are being tested, you are being made to look like a precious metal. I thought that was pretty powerful. I thought that was pretty powerful that there was this consistent theme through multiple letters where they were casting a vision to different parts of the church, and they were saying it the same way. They were saying that when you go through a test, you should count it all joy. And there are different types of tests. I mean, Pastor Mark is going to really teach on this a lot better than I could. But there are many types of tests that we go through. But over and over and over, Peter, James, Jude, John, they all say, count it all joy. But they measure it against something. They measure it against eternity. They always say, it cannot compare. It cannot compare. This light momentary affliction, it cannot compare. It may seem painful for a moment, but it cannot compare. What is to come is greater. But they go back to say that God is working in this test. Now, one of the things that we are going to cover in this series, but it's not the point of this series, is where these things come from and how God brings them to a conclusion. But what we're mostly going to talk about in this series is we're going to talk about what God expects of us as we go through a trial. What do we do in the middle of the trial? Because the reality is, everyone in this room is either in a trial, about to go into a trial, or just got out of a trial. And in this last year, we have seen personally, as your pastors, a lot of people go through trials. Myself, I have gone through a trial with my wife this last year. Many people on our staff have gone through a trial this last year or are continuing to go through a trial. And many of you have faced various trials. And so as a pastoral staff through the middle of the summer, we felt very specifically God was telling us to teach out of the book of James where he says, count it all joy, my brothers, when you face various trials. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Because this is the big idea that I want to bring to you today. That God wants you to be tested. Why? Because God is working everything for your good. Now, one of the things that I would say for years, and this was a conversation Pastor and I had, was it's obvious because God is in control and God is sovereign that God allows. You cannot argue that point. But what I would say, but it wouldn't feel good when it came out, was God uses your storm. I would say God sends your storm, but God doesn't send your storm, but God uses your storm. But when I would say it, it really didn't feel right exactly the way I meant it when it came out. And Pastor Mark, when we were having a conversation, he challenged me. He said this, and I thought this was really profound. He said, God does not even use a storm, he redeems the storm. He doesn't use a storm, he redeems a storm, because if you say he uses the storm, that means that you're saying that God uses a storm for his advantage. No. He redeems the storm for your advantage. You are his child, and he is a good father who gives good gifts and perfect gifts, according to James 1. And so we have to have that attitude that God is working all things for the good of those who are called according to his purposes. So he is redeeming it. I want you to know this. I'm going to say this right away, the type of church we are. We are a faith church. We're going to tell you to have faith. Build up your faith. Increase your faith. We are going to push you. If you lack wisdom, ask. That's what James 1 says. If you know the word, do it. That's what James 1 says. We are a church that's going to push you to believe God. We're going to push you to stand on God's promises. That's what we're going to push you to do. We're going to tell you that God is going to redeem this situation if you put it into His control. If you put it into His control, no matter what your trial is, because some are big, some are small, some are long, some are short, but if you will put it in His control, God will redeem it to your advantage. But what He's doing is He's producing something in you. I want you to know this. There is a way to go through a trial, and there is a way not to go through a trial. But we are all tested. What God wants to produce in us, here it is, steadfastness. God wants to produce in us steadfastness. He wants to redeem our trial and produce in us steadfastness, that we would be purified like a precious metal. The reason why Peter, James, Jude, and John all said this is because this was written by Old Testament prophets. And they said, in our affliction, He refines us like the refiner's fire, where we were placed in a hot metal. We were placed in the fire, and the impurities rise to the surface, and it's all washed away. That's Isaiah 48. That's Zechariah 3. And they quote it to us in the New Testament talking about our trials and tests. And they say, God is going to purify you. God is going to make you steadfast. God is going to make you solid as a rock and pure. They say it this way, as pure as gold, as precious as gold. God is going to purify you in this. We're all tested. There's many tests that we face. Like last night, as a Georgia fan, I was tested. I was tested. Got inside the red zone. I was tested. I was tested as a Georgia fan. Listen, did any of y'all enjoy that cool, crisp air this morning when you came out of the door? Hallelujah, somebody. When I feel that cool, crisp air, it means a few things for me. One, I don't have to sweat so bad anymore. I sweat terribly. Two, Lee Payne knows what I'm talking about. Amen. Me and Lee were working on something one time together, and I swear we were competing of who could sweat more. It was terrible. I won. But it's hard to be a fan this time of year, because especially a Georgia fan, because there's always so much promise every year, and we can't seem to have a defense. I don't understand what's going on. But I don't know, it's hard. Tested. But I do love this time of year because football comes, and I'm involved in football in a lot of different ways. I chaplain for a local high school team, and before last Friday night, we had not won a game in 3 years. Tested. I said to Megan before the season started, I said, you know what, I just don't love Friday nights as much as, oh, never mind, we haven't won in 3 years. That's what it is. I enjoyed last Friday. It was great. We won. We have a new coach. It's awesome. I'm praying for him. Pray for me. But it is hard to be a fan if you're a fan of anything, especially if you're a fan of a team that's not very good. But there's all types of different fans when it comes to sports. No matter what sport you enjoy, I'm sure we've got some extreme loyalists in here. I don't know how there has been this gospel of Alabama preached in this church so heavily, but there's a lot of Roll Tide fans in this church. There's a few Auburn fans. There, of course, is the loyalist Georgia fans. But I'm not going to preach on college football this morning, I promise. But there's a point to what I'm saying. There's a lot of different fans. I wrote a few down. Have you ever met an unloyal fan, like a bandwagon fan? This is the type of person that as soon as things start going wrong, they just jump right off that wagon. You know what I mean? I saw this picture online the other day. It was pretty funny. And if Miss Dye was here, she would laugh. Granddad was here. LeBron went back to Cleveland, okay? Let's just talk about it. He went back to Cleveland. And I saw this picture of LeBron where I think one time he had went to Africa or something, and he had like hundreds of people running behind him. And the little tagline on the bottom of the picture said, all the Miami fans running with LeBron back to Cleveland. But bandwagon fans, people who are easily... their loyalty is easily undone. Where something, all of a sudden, it's like they show up and they're like, man, weren't you wearing another team jersey last week, or, well, you know. And they start telling you why. A couple of weeks ago, I was at the Georgia Tech game because Preston Kilgore was so nice to invite me. And it was a lot for me, because I'm a diehard Georgia fan. First of all, when he called me, I was like, you know, I don't really own anything blue and gold, but I can figure something out. But then when I went, it was almost like when you, okay, let's just, for those people who grew up in church, you're going to understand what I'm saying. You remember when you were in the club or a party or something, and you were there and people were having a lot of fun around you, but the whole time you were thinking, they are deceived. This is a lie. This is exactly how I felt at the Georgia Tech game. They all looked like they were having so much fun, but I was like, they are deceived. This is a lie. And I was having fun too, but then I was like, it's wrong that I'm having fun. It's wrong. I am unloyal. So you can't be unloyal. You got to be loyal to one team, and you got to stick it out no matter what. And there's cynical fans. You ever met a cynical fan? I can't watch football with these types of people, because as soon as something bad happens, they say things like, typical, typical. It always happens this way. These types of people in life say things like, this is my pet peeve. I'm telling you, if you say this phrase, I want to karate chop you right in the throat. If you say this phrase, welcome to my world. Oh, I just want to gag. Cynical fans. Y'all know what I'm talking about. You've had family members like this where it's just, oh, it's woe is us, woe is us. Boston Red Sox fans before about 7 years ago, you know what I mean? Or maybe you've met a terrible fan. These are the types of people that ruin the experience for everybody, that are living vicariously through the team. You know what I'm saying? These are the dads at the baseball games where, like, the little six-year-old kid, and they're like, win for me! You know, things like that. You're better than this! Or things they say. Or they cuss out an umpire or something crazy. But terrible fans. Or you may be at their house. I know a guy, literally, when his team would lose, he'd kick everybody out. He'd be like, get out. Go home. And he just didn't want to be around people anymore. So people always kind of had their keys in their pockets, you know, they're ready to go. But terrible fans, man, that they ruin it for everybody. And they're so verbal and so just, they lose it. I mean, their world is destroyed if their team loses, because their identity is connected to it. But I thought about another fan, and these are my favorite type. Have you ever met an unshakable fan? I mean an unshakable fan. Like, you have been repping the same team for multiple decades, despite. Let me tell you what multiple fans say. This is their key phrase. There are so many people in this room right now going, with this sad look on their face, I won't walk away, you know. But they've let me down so many times. Unshakable fans, they say this. They say, yeah, but. Yeah, but. If you come to an unshakable fan and you start talking about their team or how badly they're doing, you get a, yeah, but. And there's this moment of hope that shines through the darkness of what is true that you have just said to them. Yeah, Bobo don't know what he's doing, but. And they will have this moment where they will begin. Here's what they're doing. They're pointing to the future. An unshakable fan will always tell you about what's going to happen in the future, not what's happening right now, or not what just happened last night. I can't believe what happened last night. But they're telling you about the future. They're looking to the future. Aren't you glad that you serve a God who has never lost a battle, nor is He losing anything right now, nor will we ever have to worry about an outcome, because we know how the game ends? With victory, we win. Matter of fact, it has already been won. because the Lion of Judah has conquered. He went to the cross as the Lamb, but has conquered as the Lion, and He has won. It's a sure thing. We already know how it's going to end. I remember when I was a teenager, I was so under condemnation, one, because I was very rebellious and I was living half-hearted for Jesus, but I would come so under condemnation, and I, you know, this man said to me, he said, listen, the enemy is condemning you. You are just being just overwhelmed with shame and guilt. He said, anytime you hear the enemy telling you about your past, you need to remind him of his future. You need to tell him about how it ends for him. He's telling you about what you've done. So you have a little bit of a, yeah, but, yeah, you're right. I did fail and I did make those mistakes. But the Lamb has conquered on my behalf, and He holds the keys to the pit, and He will throw you in the pit. Okay, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, but there's a yeah, but attitude that you have to have when it comes to grace. And we know how it ends, but why is it, if we know how it ends, that we act like all is lost as soon as we face a trial? A team that has no ability to go through a whole game, the first thing you'll see happen when something bad happens is they will droop their heads. You see it. You see their heads drop, and that is just an immediate sign of the wind has been taken out of their sails. You always see it with the fans. Something bad happens with the fans, and they always get that tight camera shot of that one guy who's like, just losing his mind up in the stands. It's so easy to have our legs taken out from under us in that way and to forget about the future. It's hard to have a yeah, but attitude. So I want to ask you, what kind of fan are you? More specifically, more biblically, getting away from college football, how do you handle trials or being tested by fire? Are you steadfast? If so, how so? I really want you to reflect on that today. If you're the type of person that you are a rock to other people, I want to know how. I want you to reflect on that because that's beneficial to everyone in your community, especially in your B group. But if not, why not? That's what I want to ask you today. Open your Bibles with me. I want to read from James. We're going to go to the first chapter, and I'm going to read starting at verse 12. I'm going to go all the way to 17. Here we go. I'm in the ESV version. It says this: blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love Him. Let no one say, when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and He Himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, brings death. Do not be deceived, my brothers. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Let's look deeper at this morning, okay? First thing I want to talk about is that word blessed, that God wants you to be steadfast. If you go up to the first couple of verses in this chapter, He says, count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. He says that when it shows up, rejoice because you know what God is going to do in it, and let it have its way. Let it take its full effect, and it will produce completeness and lacking in nothing. But he says, blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life. I'm going to tell you something that I've noticed, man. People get so mad when you talk faith because it's not what they feel. People get so mad when you talk faith because it is not what they feel. And the other week, Megan came up. We were talking on the way home about this last year and what has happened to us. We were having a yeah, but moment. Yeah, this happened. But double portion, restoration, life. We were having one of those conversations. And I went off to one end of the house, and Megan, she came over to where I was, and she said, I just feel like, y'all ever had one of those moments where you just feel like the Holy Spirit dropped a bomb on you? I mean, and it's so simple too. You almost feel like it's so simple it won't make sense to other people, but just for you, it was like eyes wide open. I got it. You have opened, you have enlightened the eyes of my heart, like Paul said, to this truth. And she came in and she said, I feel like God just spoke to me so clear that the reason why that fear is easier than faith is because we feel fear. Listen to what I'm saying. The reason why fear is easier than faith is because we feel fear. Let me tell you a story. When I was a teenager, I was not serving Christ at all. I became a Christian when I was a senior in high school. And one of the things that my sister and I did was we always protected each other from our parents. We would be out doing things we shouldn't do. And we lived in a kind of a small community. So we knew word of mouth traveled quickly. So if we were going to be doing things, we had to be selective with who we did them with. And we had to put fear in people to not talk about what we were doing with them. Because we went to school with cousins. Anybody from a small town knows what I'm talking about right now. I had toothpaste in my truck. You know what I'm talking about. So my sister would cover for me. I would cover for her. We'd call, hey, say mom and dad are coming home. They got homework, whatever. And this one night, my sister went out, and I was at home, and I was staying up on the couch, and then she decided that she was going to spend the night at where she was going, and so I fell asleep on the couch. And I'm laying on the couch, and it's about 4 o'clock in the morning, and there are these two French doors that go out of our kitchen onto the back porch. And the way our living room and kitchen was set up was it was ranch style. You could stand in the living room, look all the way through to those French doors and see outside into the woods. And I'm laying on the sofa like this, okay? My back is to those French doors. And about 4 o'clock in the morning, I hear someone breaking into our house. I mean, breaking into our house. And I hear those doors being just, you know, and all of a sudden I thought, man, this must be Ashley. But then I thought, no, because we sneak in. We don't bust in. We sneak in. And then as soon as that fact entered my brain, I became paralyzed with fear. Paralyzed with fear. Because they can see me. And I'm a big object. You know what I mean? And I'm sleeping on the couch. And I know they can see me, and I hear them trying to force their way in, and all of a sudden I hear, boom, and that French door open, and boom, smack the wall. And I'm talking, my heart is, I mean, it is just beating so fast. And now I'm going through all these horrible scenarios of what is happening in my home, you know. I mean, I got to get up and sacrifice myself. I mean, I'm just, all these things are going through my brain. And all of a sudden, the robber sits at the computer chair in the living room, and I look up and it's Ashley. I'm like, oh my God! And I scare her, and I'm just losing my mind. Fear is paralyzing, man. If it really sinks into your heart, you cannot move. It is unbelievable how paralyzed you can be by the confidence of fear. Fear is a confident feeling. You have confidence in something you have no evidence for. That's one of the most powerful things to me about fear, is you believe, like faith, in the worst possible outcome. You have confidence in it because you feel it. It's something that we have to battle with. And whenever someone is going through trial, if you bring faith into the situation, they may despise it for a moment. But we've got to speak faith. You've got to bring faith. You've got to be that person that brings faith. You've got to stir yourself up despite how you feel. Despite, you've got to fight what you feel to have faith for what you know. You got to fight what you feel to have faith for what you know. And in those situations, if it's your trial or their trial, man, you got to stir yourself up. Stir yourself up to have faith. They'll say things like, be realistic. You ever heard that response? Be realistic. Come on, man. I mean, it's almost like they don't want you to bring faith to the situation. But you're talking about the most real thing that there is. We all need people with rock under their feet in our life, not sand. I want to talk about it in a minute, Matthew 24, where he says, a man who puts these words of mine into action is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain comes, the wind comes, the floods come, but they are not destroyed. The man who hears these words of mine and does not put them into action is like a man who built his house on the sand. The rain come, the winds come, the floods come, and it is a mighty destruction. How many of us have people in our life, or are we the people that when the rain comes, the winds come, and the floods come, you are destroyed? You're an unloyal fan, cynical fan, or maybe you're even a terrible fan. Right? It's hard in those times to remember what we know. It's hard in those times to fight the feelings, to have faith for what we know, because feelings are contagious. I mean, if what you feel is spoken in the right way, I mean, it can just be absorbed by the people around you. They're infectious. I mean, when I used to wait tables, I learned this all the time. I mean, I could be having a meltdown in the back. My tickets could be falling apart. People could be fighting but if I walked out and I took that attitude and those feelings to my tables, my tips were terrible. And so I had to give people, you know, a good experience. But then and there is when I learned, man, attitudes are contagious. Attitudes are contagious. They're so easily adopted, and it's hard to be a person with a contagious attitude, because that means you can't be cured. You can't be cured. You're the person that's bringing the attitude, and if you become a person of contagious faith, you're the type of person that is a rock in people's life. And when I say that, you immediately think of someone. Everyone knows a steadfast person. And what I'm telling you today is that Jesus desires for you to be that person. Matter of fact, anytime life hits you, Jesus begins to redeem your trial for His glory and your good and for the good of others, because He wants you to be a rock for other people. He wants you to be a steadfast, purified like gold, precious metal, unshakable in the lives of other people. Another thing that he says, looking deeper, he says, God did not send this test. He is working it to our advantage. He's redeeming it, working it to our good. Every good gift and perfect gift is from above. The terrible fan, the worst thing I ever hear a terrible fan do is start blaming the coach. This last Friday night, I mean, I've been with the same team, this local high school team, for 3 years, and the coach before, the new coach, ran the I formation, and he ran all the time. You know, he believed in it. He believed in the I. And parents from the stands would say, "Throw the ball! Throw the ball, coach!" You know what I mean? Just making themselves, don't do that. Let me just say, can we all as a community and a church right now agree, don't be that person? All right. If you go to a Major League Baseball game and you just want to have fun and yell stuff, oh, yeah, okay. But in Douglasville, don't be that person. Please, Jesus, don't be that person. Throw the ball, coach! This last year, we have a new coach, and he runs the spread. We throw the ball 70% of the time, but we run a fast-paced offense, okay? If I'm losing you right now, hold on. It's okay. A fast-paced offense means we don't get in the huddle, okay? We never get in the huddle. We call the plays from the from the sideline, and he gives them signals, and they go. It's a quick, fast, it keeps the defense on their toes. It's a good offense. And we're having success all night against the number five team in the state, but then we start having trouble in the second quarter, and a dad, which sounded a lot like the same dad from last, put him in the huddle! Put him in the huddle, coach! I did a long turn and stare at somebody Friday night. I have no idea who he is. If he's here today, I'm talking to you. I don't know. You could be here. I don't know. But I love the fact that James, in the first chapter, says, God did not send this. He did not send this. He's not trying to prove a point to you. He's not trying to teach you a lesson. God did not send this. Let me just get real, just straight with you for a second. God will not use something that he put on the back of his son to prove something to you. He was bruised for our iniquities, wounded for our transgressions. Our healing was on his back, 40 lashes minus one. And he is not going to use the curse to teach the chosen a lesson. He is not going to use the curse to teach the chosen a lesson. God is much more creative to bring you to himself. Now, okay, here's the difference. What people say when they say that is, you're far from God. God's teaching you a lesson, and you need to run back to him. You're far from God. God's teaching you a lesson. He's trying to draw you back to himself. That's what they'll say. But you know what my scripture says? It says that if we are heartbroken, which is usually the number one symptom of someone in a trial in some way. It doesn't say how heartbroken you are. It just says heartbroken. You know what it says? It says he sticks closest to those whose hearts are broken than anyone else. He's not going to send a test by the curse to you. When your heart is hurting, he comes to you closer than he's ever been. So if someone begins to tell you that God is going to teach you a lesson by the curse, you just remind them of what Jesus did on your behalf. When Jesus said, it is finished, it is finished. It is finished. He's not going to draw you to himself by the curse. He comes closest to you when you experience the curse. Because we live in a grace dispensation. This is a bit theological right here. But there is a principle in Scripture that's called already but not yet. That's not in the Bible, but that's a theological principle. It's called already but not yet. And it's mostly taught in Hebrews. Paul addresses this to the Jewish people. And he says that everything is under the subjection of his feet, but it does not yet appear that way. Everything is under the subjection of his feet, but it does not yet appear that way. And then he later writes, I'm going to fellowship with him no matter what. In the power of his resurrection, but also in the fellowship of his suffering. Because it cannot compare. They're always pointing to the future. They're always saying, count it all joy. It cannot compare to what is coming. It cannot compare. God did not send this test. God is redeeming it for your advantage. God is using it to produce in you steadfastness. And he says to us, count it all joy. Because when it comes, when these trials come, whether small or big or short or long, know that your Father is in control. Know that the victory has already been won. You know how it ends. You know how it ends. So what do we take from this? What do we do with this new knowledge this morning? How do we put this into action? Let me say two things. For others, don't try to be perfect, but be perfect for their situation. Don't try to be perfect, but be perfect for their situation. Y'all know what I mean, right? Where there has been something happen in your life. I was really moved a couple of weeks ago when when Jeremy came up here and was teaching us about care. And whenever they experienced a loss, when they experienced a trial, it was their B group leaders, or their small group leaders, who were the only people besides their family who showed up to support them in their trial. And he's still talking about it nearly 20 years later. That's a person who is not perfect, but is perfect for the situation. You can be imperfect, but be perfect for a situation. And so when it comes to other people's trials and tests, we are meant to bear with each other's burdens. We're meant to help carry the load for each other. So be perfect for their situation. But for yourself, let it take its full effect. Whatever your trial is, let it take its full effect. Mourn fully. Let it in. Face the facts. And then speak faith. Face the facts and then speak faith. You don't need to excuse God. You don't need to explain it away. And it is very difficult to find a reason. I want you to know that. I want you to know it is very difficult to find a reason for trials. Because we want so badly to know exactly why something is happening or has happened. But I heard something years ago, and this really ministered to me. Because people want to know, okay, God is in control, but how much in control is He? And they said something. I heard a pastor say this. He said, if you try to figure out how much God is in control in every single situation, you're going to find yourself shipwrecked. And that's what James says. He says that if you're lacking wisdom and when your faith is being tested, he says that you have got to have faith. He says you've got to have faith. Otherwise, you will be tossed back and forth. And you should not expect to get anything from God. But what this pastor said was, when you find yourself in those situations, because here's the typical thing a person says in trial. Where is God? Why doesn't He do something? Even the other day, I sat in an office with someone, and they wanted to know, why doesn't God do something for a particular thing? And I just simply said to them, with as much gentleness and humility as I could, He did. He did. You're asking where He is. You need to ask where He was 2,000 years ago. He was on the cross. Because when we start to try to figure out where exactly God is and what He's doing and how He's doing it and why this happened and all these things, what you need to remind yourself of is that He perfectly, perfectly orchestrated the death, life, crucifixion, burial, and resurrection of His Son on your behalf. Isaiah says it pleased the Father to crush Him on our behalf. Hebrews says that Jesus was able to endure the cross because of the joy set before Him. You know what that joy was? You and me. You and me was what helped Jesus to endure. Jesus looked to the future. It was the future that motivated Him through what He did. And Paul writes, we should look to Jesus as our example. So His endurance through the cross is our example of what we go through in trial. To be made steadfast. To be made steadfast. You got to have a yeah, but attitude. This is my trial. Yeah. But. This past year, everyone knows that Megan and I experienced a loss of a pregnancy. And there were two passages that were very important to us. Because to me, one of the most important things that James writes in this first chapter is, don't just hear the word, do it. Don't just hear it, do it. Put it into action, put it into action. Someone texts me a few days after everything had happened and I had read this chapter the day before, and I felt like it was pretty powerful. But it was the story out of 2 Samuel 12, where David loses a child, And what's so powerful to me in that story is how he reacts, okay? Because it says that he just dropped himself on the altar and worshiped and fasted and prayed. But when the news came of what had happened, it says he got up, he washed his face, and then they asked him, why do you get up now? Why do you eat now? Why are you doing this? And he says, God is in control. That's his basic answer. He says, God is in control. He said, I fasted and prayed while God may be gracious to me. He says, but I can no longer go to him. Oh, he can no longer come back to me, but I will go to him. And it says he got up and he worshiped. He got up and he worshiped. To me, you have to look at David's whole life. Go all the way back to when he was in a sheep field. And it says he was a skillful worshiper. Stayed in the field and worshiped. And even when Saul needed someone to play for him, he called for David because David had skill. That David just carried the presence everywhere he went. When a lion showed up, when a bear showed up, which is what gave David. David was just that rock. He was that dude that showed up and did well under pressure. He did well in a crisis. He was that rock. He had been tested by fire. And when situations came, he went back to the very first thing that had always given him strength. He went back to that God was in control. You have to know that God is in control to walk out into the middle of the valley of Elah looking at a 9-foot-tall Philistine. But he had seen the lion, he had seen the bear, and he knew that God was in control. He knew that God was in control. And even in this situation, he knew the end. He knew who was in control. And then the second one was what I said to you a few moments ago, Matthew 24:7, where he says, a wise man is a man who hears my words and puts them into action. When he does that, he is a rock. He's standing on the rock and becomes a rock. The way we become steadfast is we look to the rock. That's what Paul writes in Hebrews 12. We endure looking to Jesus, who is our example, who for the joy set before him endured the cross. So, listen to what I'm about to say to you. We were his motivation. Now he is our motivation. We were his motivation. Now, he is our motivation. And if we put his words into action, because he's given us many great promises. And the only thing I can tell you this morning is you've got to wash each other with the word. And I say each other, community, as a church, we've got to wash each other with the word. As family, as husband, as wife, you've got to strengthen each other by the word. Stand up. I want to read word to you this morning. This is how I want to end today. I'm just going to read you a bunch of scriptures. And I hope you feel strength. But I want to ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes. And I want to let you hear what God is promising to you in trial. I don't have all the answers for you this morning. I am not capable of that. But I do have strength for you. So I want to ask you to bow your heads, close your eyes, and I want you to hear what the Word says. And you can even have these if you want afterward. I will send them to you. 2 Corinthians 4:8 says, we are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed. It goes on in verse 16 to say, we do not lose heart. Though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. As we look not to the things that are seen, but the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. Philippians 4:13 says, I can do everything through him who gives me strength. Isaiah 40:29 says, he gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Ephesians 6:10 says, finally, Be strong in the Lord and His mighty power. Isaiah 40 and 31 says, but those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Mark 12 and 30 says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with your mind, and with all your strength. 2 Corinthians 12 and 9 says, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Psalms 46 and 1 says, God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Romans 8 and 31 says, what then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? And let me tell you how it ends. Revelation 21, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be His people, and God Himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore. For the former things have passed away. And He who was seated on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. I am making all things new. Bow your heads.